Today is a good day, a day full of promise and sunrise out to greet you, the road rising up to meet you. All troubles are a million, million miles away. You got time on your hands, a time to take
hello. This is Eugenie Jones. Welcome, welcome to Personal Best, where we discuss the life components that define us, wellness, lifestyle, family, career, and all the qualities and characteristics within those components that help us live our lives to the fullest, intentionally, at our personal best. So let's sit back and enjoy the cool sounds of jazz as we progressively learn, grow, and become better versions of who we are.
Oh, it couldn't be better. So many pleasures to take into.
We have a wonderful, wonderful guest with us here today. Legendary trombonist, educator, curator, luminary in the world of jazz, Mr. Julian Priester is here with us today. Hello, Julian.
Hello, Eugenie.
So excited that you're here.
Good.
So we are talking about longevity because... I'm not going to say that. But you are... Tell us your age. So you can't say I told it.
Well, I'm 86. I'll be 87 next month.
Wow. Yeah. June 29th, right?
June 29th.
I'm counting down the days. Where's the party? That's what I want to know.
Well, I haven't gotten there yet.
So we were talking about longevity, and I wanted you to come in and talk because you are someone who has reached the ripe age that you have, but you also have a wonderful career behind you, and you're still engaged in that career today.
Yes.
And still engaged in your community today.
Yes.
And so you are a perfect example of not just living, but living to your fullest, living to your personal best. And
yes.
So talk to us a little bit about, you know, your career as you got started as a young man,
mm-hmm.
discovering this talent and pursuing your music career. Tell us a little bit about that.
Okay, all right. I'm very fortunate to have lived with and grown up with a wonderful family. I'm the baby of the family. I'm the youngest of five boys and one girl. I think my mom was a little bit disappointed that I wasn't a girl. But by the time it got around to me, I think she was done.
Wow. Yeah.
So she accepted it. That's it. She was wonderful. You know, she had me in an environment that was everything that I needed to develop into a whole person. You know, my father was a Baptist minister. My mom played the piano. We had a piano in our home, which is really critical to...
Right, to have access to instruments.
Have access to instrument and access to music because we had a record player. One of my siblings was a jazz fan.
Okay.
And he played his records, and his friends would come over and listen to music, and they would get so excited just listening to this music.
Mm-hmm.
We had the needle, and they would take the needle off the record and put it back to play one passage over and over that they liked this passage.
Right.
And they played it so often that it stuck in my ear.
Mm-hmm.
The sound of it stuck in my ear, and I would go to the piano and try and, find that sound on the piano.
Gotcha.
And, you know, that was my introduction.
Uh-huh. You know, did your mother encourage you to explore music, to play at that age?
I'm sure she would have if she had, she passed away.
Oh.
When I was nine.
Okay.
And I'm sure she would have. You know, yeah. But by that time, though, I think that I had already caught the bug.
Uh-huh.
You know, the music bug. And the process of going to the piano and trying to recreate the sounds that my siblings were so excited about. I fell in love with the music without really knowing exactly what I was getting into.
Right.
I think that the decision for my future was settled, you know, without me really knowing it. But so I went on. My stepmother discovered that I was interested in music. She gave, and piano in particular. She arranged for me to have piano lessons.
Oh, okay. So now you have access to an environment conducive for music with your siblings,
yes,
introducing you to music. You have access to a record player.
Yes.
You have a piano in your home.
Yes.
And you have somebody willing to pay for you to have lessons.
Right.
I mean, the reason I'm pointing this out is because these are foundational pieces for people being able to get access into music, don't you think?
Yes. Yes, but you know, that I have to chuckle now because thinking back on it, it was kind of, fortunate that, let me tell you the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
Since I had already absorbed music from listening to my brother's records and going to the piano and finding those sounds on the piano, mm-hmm, I developed an ear for the music. When I got to the piano lessons,
mm-hmm,
I would have my cousin play the piano, play my lesson, and I would memorize it.
Yeah, I kind of knew where you were going with this, but go ahead.
I would memorize my lesson. I would go back to my lesson play my lesson for my piano teacher. And of course, she wasn't stupid. You know, I mean, I thought I could just do that and get away with it.
Right.
But she tricked me. She put a piece of music on the piano for me to play. It was actually supposed to be my lesson. So that's what I thought.
Uh-huh.
So I was playing one thing, and there was another piece of music up there that I was supposed to be playing. Mm-hmm. I was playing by ear, and I wasn't reading. I didn't know how to read. Trying to cheat.
Uh-huh,
you know,
uh-huh.
I felt that I was already there.
Right.
You know. Anyway, she busted me.
Uh-huh. And so you began, well, around what age was that when you began
I was
instruction?
About 11.
11.
Yeah.
When did you realize, I mean, when did you start wanting to play professionally? You went from being a student to a practitioner. When did that happen?
In high school, yeah. I wanted to play in the jazz band. And I wanted to play piano in the beginning because I was familiar with the piano by then.
Mm-hmm.
But there were other students who also wanted to play piano. There was a line that I had to get into the back of the line, and I didn't want to do that.
Gotcha.
So my band instructor, knowing that I was familiar with the piano, suggested and gave me an instrument that sort of based on keyboards, with like similar to the piano keyboards.
Mm-hmm.
An instrument called a glockenspiel.
Oh, okay.
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 That I wore it in a harness around, and it had keys like a piano, but they were metal keys.
Mm-hmm.
And you strike the metal keys with the mallets.
Gotcha.
Wooden mallets on these metal keys.
Mm-hmm.
The sound was so horrible. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand the sound of this. So I asked my band instructor if I could play a horn. Just to get away from the
glockenspiel. To get away from that.
I didn't know what kind of horn I would play. I just wanted to get away from the glockenspiel.
Right.
And I remember hearing something about one of my older siblings had once played the trumpet. So I just said, okay, I want to play the trumpet.
Right.
All right. There was also a line of students wanted to play the trumpet. I had to get there, right? So my band instructor gave me an instrument called the euphonium.
Mm.
The euphonium, if you're not familiar with it, it's one of those instruments that you find in a Salvation Army band. It's like a baby tuba.
Oh, okay. You know, gotcha.
And it's got three valves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, similar to, in fact, exactly like the valves on a trumpet.
Okay.
So I learned all the figurines for the baritone horn, or actually the proper name for it is euphonium.
Mm-hmm.
It's also called a baritone horn.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I learned all the fingers for that, and it turned out that there's no precedent for the baritone horn in jazz, and I wanted to play a jazz musician.
Ah.
So fortunately, again, turned out that the mouthpiece that he used on the baritone horn is the same mouthpiece that he used on a trombone.
Wow. Wow.
So.
Yeah. Look how that came together.
Yeah.
Look how that came together.
Yeah, so I.
So you, but you reached your desired outcome, which was to be in a jazz band.
Yes, yes.
And you using an instrument that you hadn't planned on.
Right.
But had an affinity for when you began?
Well, yeah, I wanted to be in a jazz band.
But the instrument, when you started playing the trombone, what was your feeling about it? It was kind of happenstance that you're there now, but now that you're there, what was your feeling?
There was other trombone players that I listened to recordings.
Uh-huh.
J.J. Johnson was one, the main one, actually, because he was a modern jazz trombone player. There were others mm-hmm. who were older, but Dixieland players, and I wasn't, you know, it was the 1950s.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
I wasn't into Dixieland, although Dixieland and the trombone sort of go together. I played around with it, but I wasn't mm-hmm. really serious about playing. Mm-hmm. Being a Dixieland trombonist.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I wanted to be a jazz trombonist, you know.
Yes.
I wanted to play like Charlie Parker. But technically, there's no way I could play like Charlie Parker with a trombone.
Right.
But I still try.
Mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm.
I use Charlie Parker as a model, role model. I dabbled into J.J. Johnson's career because he was a trombonist. He was the premier trombonist during that particular era. So he was a natural person for me to gravitate toward.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But fortunately, I had a friend who played saxophone. He was in high school with me. His name is Charles Davis. He played baritone saxophone.
Gotcha.
And it turned out the baritone saxophone and the trombone are kind of matched mm-hmm. timbre-wise mm-hmm. and as far as the range of the two instruments.
Right.
And Charles was in the band with me. So we became very good, tight friends. We became study mates, and we would learned Charlie Parker solos. You know, mm-hmm. he could play them, but I could play Adam.
Yeah.
And it actually it helped me to develop my own style, you know. And it also helped me not to have to use J.J. Johnson as my mentor. You know, I didn't want to copy J.J. Johnson
right.
because I wouldn't get any recognition
right.
individually, you know. As, right. as a matter of fact, even though I was striving to stay away from J.J. Johnson, they would... some of the public who were in the jazz,
right,
would thinking they were complimenting me, called me Little JJ.
Oh, not a compliment.
No, not a compliment. No.
Okay, yeah. So here we are. We're starting off at a young age, introduced to music, having access to lessons of piano. Now you're in high school.
I'm in high school.
You're in high school now, and you've found your instrument.
I found my instrument.
You've also found your path to individuality.
Yes.
By identifying how you are going to study and learn your art.
Right.
Unique from everybody else. I think that's a very key segue or
yes
well not a segue but a key point in our lives when we realize who we are
yes.
and why we're here, so to speak.
Yes
would you say that was your kind of your moment for you that gave clarity to your life? That did you know it at that point that this is me, this is the path I'm going to follow, pursuing trombone?
I wasn't thinking about it in those terms.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to get, you know, absorb all the music, that all the jazz music that I could.
Gotcha.
And I wasn't thinking about career. I wasn't thinking about identification. I just wanted to be.
Yeah.
I wanted to be Charlie Parker.
All right. So our topic today is longevity, and we have the honor of having Mr. Julian Priester in the studio with us today. We're going to take a break and listen to one of Julian's most recent recordings. I have the honor of it being on my CD players, and it's Multicolored Blue by Billy Strayhorn, featuring Julian Priester on trombone, Jay Thomas on trumpet, Bill Anschell on piano, Clipper Anderson on bass, and Devon Lewis on drums. Here we go with Multicolored Blue. Thank you.
a daffodil, violet in the morning sky, red the rose, purple the night, brown the autumn leaf,
blue, my heart, my heart.
with legendary trombonist Julian Priester. Our topic on Personal Best today is longevity, and Julian celebrating his 87th birthday on June 29th is a perfect example of longevity in its finest. Julian has shared his early years with us. Now we're segueing into what came next after he discovered his love for the trombone.
You found your instrument.
I found my instrument.
You've also found your path to individuality.
Yes.
So how did, what was your moment? What was your breakthrough, you know, that actually introduced Julian Priester to the big stage where everybody was like, wow, check out Julian Priester.
Yeah.
What was that? Or was it a multiple series of things that got you to that point?
I credit my high school band director. He was a retired army captain,
mm-hmm.
and he ran that band like the students were
in the army.
In the army, discipline was uh-huh. his mantra.
Okay.
Discipline, and also Norman Vincent Peale had written a book, and the subject of this book was positive thinking.
Yes. Yes.
Captain Diet had read that book, and he had adopted that mm-hmm. philosophy, mm-hmm. and he wanted the students to also adopt that, mm-hmm. that philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
I went for it. Think positive. Positive things will happen for you.
Mm-hmm.
Have a trombone, and I'm for hire.
Yeah.
That was my attitude.
Mm-hmm.
And it went on that way for years until later on in my career. I was working with Duke Ellington at the time,
mm-hmm.
and we were on a tour. We were in Europe, and we were walking. It was actually we were touring the army camps there, and we were using the army equipment, airplanes. You know, they weren't commercial airplanes. We were on. We were on
freight.
Freight, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we felt like freight because there were no real seats. There was seats. There were benches along the edge, on the sides of the album, and I was sitting on the bench trying to get comfortable, and that just happened to cross my leg. And Duke actually was sitting opposite me. When the plane landed at the army base, we disembarked, and I was just happened to be walking next to Duke, and we started a conversation. I'd ask him about rehearsal that we had experienced, and at this rehearsal, it happened to be done in a studio. It was actually a recording studio, and there were people setting up microphones to actually record.
Mm-hmm.
But in my mind, we were supposed to be rehearsing. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to clear up. So I asked Duke, you know, what is all this setting up microphones if we're supposed to be rehearsing?
Mm-hmm.
And as he answered my question on this airfield, he asked me, Julian, what do you want? You know? After all, you're just a trombone player.
Ah.
Hello.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a trombone player.
Hmm.
That was a reality that I didn't know about.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Because you had made a lot of sacrifices to be that trombone player.
Yeah,
basically, all the other elements of your life were set aside to be this thing that now he's qualifying it with the just.
Just a trombone player.
Yeah.
So I decided to remedy that,
mm-hmm.
being just a trombone player.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of being I had to change my attitude toward who I was, mm-hmm. what I was involved with. Mm-hmm. I didn't think that being just a trombone player was enough for me. Because what he was telling me was true. Mm-hmm. I was just a trombone player at the time. So I changed the way I approached music. Instead of being just a trombone player, having a trombone and being for hire, I decided to be an individual, develop my sound, develop my individuality, form my own band. And instead of being a commercial musician, I changed my character to now I'm a jazz artist. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm an artist. Don't call me a musician. I mean, mm-hmm. I was a musician, but now I've developed into an artist.
Right.
So I'm gonna carry myself and act like an artist, and I'm gonna accept performance opportunities. And I'd rather play on stage instead of in the club.
Mm-hmm. Now, what age were you at that point? Do you recall what age you were around that time?
Oh, I had to be, let's see, this was in the late 60s. Mm-hmm. So I had to be in my mid-30s.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, I had been the studio musician. Mm-hmm. You know, I had an answering service. You know, I was prepared. You know?
And then you had this wake-up call that said, the way that I'm perceiving myself is not the way other people are perceiving me.
Yeah.
And in order for me to accomplish what I want to accomplish, I got to change my mindset. Right.
Yes.
And so you're performing as a professional musician at that time.
I was.
I mean, you're in Duke Ellington's band. Who else were you playing with? Who were some of the other artists that you were with?
Oh, I was, like I said, I had an answering service, and I would get calls from strangers to go and record. And mm-hmm. As a musician, that's what I would do.
Yeah.
A lot of the recordings, I didn't really get credit. I was just, I had a trombone. I was trombone for hire.
Right.
You know, I just happened to be playing the trombone, but they actually were hiring the trombone, not
you personally.
Not me personally, because I had that. My image was just a musician.
Mm-hmm. You know. So what happened when you made this decision? You had this life altering moment where you're stopped. Where you're like, I'm not going to be just a musician. Just a player. I am going to become an artist.
Yeah.
What was the thing that you did differently at that point?
I formed my own band.
Okay.
Yeah. I felt that, okay, if I get some credit for being a band leader,
mm-hmm.
That's a step up from being just a musician.
Gotcha.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But it's funny how life turns. You know, I was in New York. I'd gotten some people together to perform with me. In my mind, I had this was my band, mm-hmm. and we were rehearsing, and we were getting ready to, you know, to go out and hustle some gigs.
Mm-hmm.
While I was doing that, I got a call from a friend who's also a trombone player, and he was working with Herbie Hancock at the time.
Okay.
He was also an arranger, composer, mm-hmm. and he had an assignment to arrange some music for a singer. I don't know exactly what the person's name was. But anyway, he had asked me to substitute for him in the Herbie mm-hmm. Hancock band.
Mm-hmm.
So I took off from what I was doing at the time, which was working rehearsing my own band.
Mm-hmm.
Also, my funds had sort of started getting a little scarce there, so I had to earn some money.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt, okay, I'll do this 3 weeks with Herbie Hancock and earn some money, and then I can go back and
mm-hmm.
and finish my project.
Mm-hmm.
When I got to Herbie Hancock's band, I really started to realize that the direction that Herbie Hancock was going was really close to to the direction that I wanted to go in with my band.
Mm-hmm.
And coincidentally, Garnet Brown, who's the trombone player whose place I was taking,
mm-hmm.
didn't come back.
Uh-huh.
So here I am in Herbie's band, liking it.
Mm-hmm.
So I changed my mind, and instead of going back and developing my own band, I stayed with Herbie.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a good move because Herbie was he had the name, and the association with Herbie helped my name to become larger.
Mm-hmm.
And the music that we were playing in Herbie's band was not commercial.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt like I was really sticking to my goal to be an artist rather than being just a musician,
right.
Having a horn and I'm for hire.
Right.
You know.
So you had played with Duke Ellington's band. You ended up transitioning into Herbie Hancock's and being more than a sub. Now you're a regular member of the band.
Yes.
But I want to take you back for a moment because I know chronologically, before Herbie Hancock, you recorded your album.
Yes.
Your first album.
Yes.
Tell us about that first album.
All right. That first album came about as a result of me actually moving to New York from Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
I arranged to get my friend, who also wanted to go to New York, he had a car. He had an automobile.
Important thing, have a car.
Have a car, yeah. So we got in this car and drove from Chicago to New York. Got to New York and so just so happened that Theolonious Monk was performing at the Five Spot Club in New York. And Johnny Griffin, saxophone player from Chicago, was working with Theolonious Monk.
Wow.
So I took advantage of the fact that I knew Johnny Griffin.
Mm-hmm.
So I went straight to the club where Johnny was, where he was working with Monk. And Johnny was happy to see me.
Mm-hmm.
He invited me to go to his apartment after the performance with Monk.
Mm-hmm.
And it just so happened, Monk also came along. Johnny took us to his apartment and fixed breakfast for us. And then how things developed. The automobile that we had used to drive from Chicago to New York, it was parked in front of Johnny Griffin's apartment. And this is when we're talking about 3 or 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning now.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden we hear this loud crash sound.
Not a good sound.
Not a good sound at all. We looked out the window and the car, the old automobile that we had driven from Chicago to New York, that we had parked it in front of Johnny Griffin's apartment, was now sitting in the middle of the street, askew.
Hmm.
It wasn't even, you know, going in the lane straight.
Mm-hmm.
It was, so naturally, it had altercation with, you know, I mean, it wasn't the car that had altercation. It was the person who hit the car that had altercation. I mean, how do you run into a parked car? How do you do that?
Yeah.
But they did.
Yeah.
They destroyed the car. Yeah. So my poor friend whose car it was so brought down by the car being total that he went back to Chicago. I stayed in New York. Johnny Griffin the next day took me to Riverside Records and introduced me to Orrin Keepnews, who was at the time the vice president of mm-hmm. Riverside Records. And Orrin Keepnews gave me a job in the shipping department.
Mm-hmm.
You know, packing boxes, records, putting records in boxes,
right, right,
putting labels on the boxes and shipping them out.
Uh-huh,
you know.
Uh-huh.
And I earned some money so I can now pay for an apartment. So I got my own little room. I wouldn't call it an apartment. It was a nice little room, you know. The door opened and it was so small that the chest of drawers was so close to the door. You couldn't open the door all the way. You start opening it wide enough so you could squeeze through. But it was a room and it had a bed in it. So
yeah.
I was happy. I was in New York, you know. I mean, what could go wrong?
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Yeah. But I was working in the shipping department at Riverside Records, And Johnny had talked Oren Kepnos to record with me. Record me. And I also had an opportunity to record with some other jazz artists. Philly Joe Jones was one of them. And Johnny Griffin's own album, I recorded with that. And I was invited to make my own album, and which I did. Spiritsville.
Oh, okay.
Came out of that.
Spiritsville came out of that. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And also the second album, Keep Swinging was the first one.
Okay. Spiritsville
was,
second.
Spiritsville was the second one, yeah.
All right.
So
you had recorded Keep Swinging.
Yes.
You on trombone.
Yes.
Tommy Flanagan on piano.
Yes.
Sam Jones on bass and Elvin Jones on drums.
Right.
Yeah.
How could you go wrong with that rhythm section?
Apparently not.
No.
That was your breakthrough as an individual artist. That was your breakthrough moment, right?
Right.
Yeah.
That elevated my image in New York.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you're right. That was my breakthrough because with that association, people just assumed that I was great. Yeah. As great as Tommy Flanagan and Sam Jones and Elvin Jones, they were monsters, all three of them.
Yeah. And you see this pattern repeating in our industry where you have a younger upstart, fledgling.
Upstart, I like that.
Yeah. And, well, they are because they don't have the legs under them that someone like you has.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm guilty of this too. You know, as a young artist trying to say, I have value, listen to me.
Yeah.
You know, and people are like, we don't know you from a can of paint. We're not listening to you.
A can of paint.
Okay, yeah. So what if Julian is on my project? And would you listen to me if Julian's there with me?
Yeah.
And so I reached out to you and we recorded a number of tracks together. Yes. My favorite, Multicolored Blue.
Yes.
And I'm not saying this because it's my recording, but there were no vocals on it at all, you should go and pull up that song and listen to it because there's this exchange, this call and response between you and Jay Thomas on trumpet.
Yes.
That is absolutely magical.
Oh, right.
Magical.
I've listened to it. I've listened to more.
So now, just to wrap up this conversation about your career, you know, your start as a young man, access to music and instruction, and then finding your instrument in high school, taking the trip from Chicago to New York and hooking up with the studio that allowed you to have an income so that you could do your music.
Yes.
And then later connecting with Herbie Hancock. There's other artists in the middle of all that. But when we're talking about the idea of longevity, here you are now. Back then, we're talking in your 30s. Here you are now and as an 80-something-year-old man.
Yeah.
Do you see something about you in terms of your attitude or your beliefs or your practices that has been a line of continuity throughout your life that has allowed you to continue to be here now, viable and engaged in your life?
I've credited all of that with the teaching from Captain Diet, positive thinking.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've held on to that practice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was convinced that positive thinking had merit.
Mm-hmm.
It was proven to me one occasion when I was still married that I was short on money, and I had made a decision that I was going to go out and find some money.
Mm-hmm.
And I went out, and in Chicago, there's a large park that baseball games are played out there. There's a meadow that's as large, so large that actually two actual baseball games can be played simultaneously, because this meadow was so large.
Mm-hmm.
So I was walking across this meadow, and something caught my eye, glistening. The sun was glistening on something that was shining. And when I reached down to pick it up, it was a coin. It was money. And as I was picking it up, I saw more money. Close. I've forgotten exactly how much it was, but it was money that I had made a decision to go out and find some money, and I went out and I found some money. So that whole philosophy about positive thinking was solidified. You know, if I didn't believe it before, I certainly had believed it after. I've carried it with me to this day.
So we're going to listen to one of your songs from your first album. This song is called Julian's Tune. So we're going to listen to that. And when we come back, we're going to continue this conversation about longevity and talk about beyond your positive attitude, what other habits do you have that you think have contributed to you being here at the ripe age of 85, soon to be 86?
86, soon to be 87.
86, soon to be 87. You still look 40. So. But right now, let's check out from Keep Swinging, Julian's first album. It was released in 1960. This tune is called Julian's Tune. It features Julian Priester on trombone, Tommy Flanagan on piano, Sam Jones on bass, and Elvin Jones on drums.
Thank you.
And we're back. Have the great honor of talking to legendary trombonist Julian Priester, who has such an incredible career that we would just take up the whole hour of this show listing his performances and recordings and all the work that he's done over the course of his career. But we're talking in the context of Julian's longevity. Why is Julian still here? Besides the blessing of life, what has he done to curate this life and to be able to be viable at 86, soon to be 87 years of age? So before I start delving into Julian's lifestyle, I want to share some information with you about, you know, the research that I've been doing talking about longevity. And there was a Healthline challenge that was published that talked about habits that lend themselves towards people leading healthier lives, leading long lives, leading quality lives. And some of those things include, get out your pencils and paper and jot this down, avoid overeating. Calorie intake and longevity are very closely connected.
Yeah.
So limiting your calories may help you live longer and protect against disease. However, that's always an ongoing research issue, but it makes common sense that if you overeat, you're overweight, and overweight leads to health issues.
Right.
Another interesting thing that they recommend was eating more nuts, and my girlfriend Annie was over the hill happy about this one because she apparently keeps lots of stashes of nuts all over the place. I gave her the 100 calorie pack to familiarize herself with the portion control when it comes to nuts, but nuts have benefit. Also, turmeric is another thing that they say is a good thing for us to ingest because it has anti-inflammatory properties and can help us lead healthier lifespans. And here's not a surprise again, eating healthy plant-based foods, you know, fruits, vegetables, nuts, seeds, whole grains, and beans may decrease the risk of your heart disease risk, such as diabetes, heart disease, et cetera. At the same time, it's promoting your longevity. Staying physically active. So I'm going to be interested to hear what Julian has to say about this, about staying physically active. How much does he exercise? We're going to find that out, too. Don't smoke. Smoking is directly linked to disease and early death. Moderate alcohol intake. And this moderate is a point of discussion. But let's hear what Julian says about alcohol consumption. He had some late nights out there hanging out at those clubs. How's his life vary now compared to the club days? And then finally, prioritizing your happiness, making sure that you make an effort at staying happy. And Julian's spoken to that a little bit about this positive thinking. Having a happiness quota in your life increases your longevity. And at the same time, trying not to be stressed out and anxious. You know, stress has a negative impact on our lives.
Yes, it does.
And friends, you know, making sure that you have a concerted effort to surround yourself with positive people, have a supportive social structure around you, as opposed to living life alone and without people.
Oh, yeah.
And this is kind of funny, Julian. One of the items, so looking at what you have sitting in front of you, drink coffee or tea.
Yeah,
because Julian's sipping on a hot cup of coffee right now.
Yeah,
and then finally having a good sleeping pattern, that makes a big difference in our longevity. So all those things contribute to our longevity, and you may practice some of those, you may not practice some of those. So the jazz, when we talk about the jazz life, especially in the era that you were performing and circulating out there, there weren't the no smoking clauses in the clubs.
No.
So you were surrounded by cigarette smoke all the time.
Yes.
And the very nature of the job, you were sleeping late and starting your days late and keeping all kinds of odd hours.
Yes.
And I imagine with the traveling, you probably were, you know, compromised in terms of your eating choices.
Yes.
So all those things had negative impact, and the consequences you went through, you had these surgeries. Would you say that was kind of like a consequence of your lifestyle?
Right.
That those surgeries were a consequence of your lifestyle?
Yes.
So what I would like for you to speak to is the fact that people go through stuff like this. Some people survive it and come out the other end stronger.
Right.
And some people are crushed by it.
Yes.
You don't strike me as somebody that's crushed,
no,
Julian.
No.
So how did you manage that? What's going on in here in your head and your heart that carried you through that?
The positive thinking carried me through that. Mm-hmm. I didn't think that I was at risk, even with the transplant. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was fooling myself. It was very fragile.
Mm-hmm.
I still am. But even to this day, I have an attitude where I'm still picking up the trombone, not as often as I should, but I'm picking it up with the hope of gaining enough strength to be able to perform again.
Mm-hmm.
Playing the trombone is very physical. I have to manage the physicality of it.
Mm-hmm.
The mental part, I've got handle.
Mm-hmm.
But the physical part, I'm still talking to my body. Say, okay, we can do this now. All right, you ready? Say something negative to the mirror as I'm passing. Yeah, I use the mirror to talk to.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
I concur with you. I believe there's a scripture that says, as a man thinketh, so is he.
Yeah. I have that ingrained in me because I mentioned that my dad was a minister.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up in the church
mm-hmm.
until my mom died.
Mm-hmm.
And the circumstances that surrounded that death turned me mm-hmm. against the church.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I was turned against the church, I was turned against going to church.
But would you say that you still have some of those elements of your foundational beliefs that came from
the church? My conduct and the way I live is still influenced.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the work that you're doing and have done and continue to do is certainly contributing to people defining it and discovering it and understanding the importance of it and the longevity of your career. Your music career, but then also your personage, who you are as a person, Julian,
mm-hmm.
is unique. It's I really feel like it's a really positive thing to be in the company of someone like you, that you have to be careful, and we're talking about longevity, to surround yourself with a circle of friends that are steel sharp and steel,
yeah,
so to speak, that will uphold you and encourage you and push you towards being the best your best you can possibly be. And I know that 30 years of being a teacher at Cornish, I know you've done that for a lot of people.
Yeah.
And some of your students have gone on to do some incredible bodies of work.
Yeah.
But we're wrapping up our conversation today, and I just want to ask you one more question. I give up asking you the question about what you're eating for breakfast,
because okay.
you've avoided that one significantly well, so I'll leave you alone about that.
Okay.
But if you were going to speak to, give someone advice, me, for instance, you're ahead of me in years.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to me, Eugenie, your longevity is really contingent upon fill in the blank. What advice would you say for in order for me to have longevity in life and career?
Oh boy. Okay. Follow your heart. Okay. And I think that you're on the right path already from what my experience with you. I've known you now for what, 3-4 years?
I think it's like 4 or 5 years now.
4 or 5 years, yeah.
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 So I've got a good idea of your personality.
Yeah. Besides being a hard charger and,
like, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're great. You're great in my view. If I could bottle it, I would.
No, but before I let you go, though, I have to say about, exercise. You admitted off air that you are exercising, that you have a pair of what? What was that again?
Oh, yeah, 5-pound weights.
Okay, all right, okay. So you got some 5-pound weights working towards building that strength.
Yeah.
Well, Julian, thank you so very, very much.
Thank you.
From the bottom of my heart, spending this time talking about longevity and sharing the bits and pieces of pearls of wisdom from your career, from your music career, your life as a teacher and educator, and even your life now in educating and inspiring.
I still credit Walter Diet for giving me the information that I could build on. After 22 years, I'm still with a borrowed liver. I'm still able to get up out of the bed in the morning. My gait's slow, but I got some help here. I feel pretty good about life.
Thank you, Julian. And this is Eugenie Jones, signing off from Personal Best, where our topic today was longevity with guest legendary trombonist Julian Priester. We hope that you've enjoyed today's conversation and that you take away with you some pearls of wisdom about longevity. We want to wrap up today's session with one final track from Julian's Keep Swinging album. This one is called Bob T's Blues. It features Julian Priester on trombone, Jimmy Heath on tenor sax, Tommy Flanagan on piano, Sam Jones on bass, and Elvin Jones on drums. Thank you so much for being here. Have a wonderful day. Now, you go be great. The top of 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 the top of